have our opening prayer with our brother.
Morning, church. Heavenly Father, this is prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, your goodness, and mercy. We thank you for coming to your house to serve you and praise you. Yes. Pray this morning to go to a service bureau, Pastor, Lord, and give him the words that you need, Lord. Open our hearts and our mind, Lord. We pray and thank you for this congregation. We pray for those on their way. Give them travel, journey, and mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, you may be seated. Good morning, everyone. Praise the Lord that you're here with us this morning. And we're glad to see each and every one of you here. Amen. We're glad to be in the house of the Lord. We've got several that are online with us also. So we praise the Lord for you. And we're glad that you are here with us. And let's remember also, folks, when we're praying for one another, let's remember to be in prayer for those that are online, that are watching us. Many cannot be here. And the Lord has blessed us to be able to be a blessing to those that simply can't make it and can't be here. So let's continue to be in prayer for them. And also know that they continue to support the ministry. So praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
That's not only saying, but it's also doing.
Amen.
And I understand, I was checking with them back there a little earlier, and our dear sister Tasha is with us this morning, and
Amen.
She's on the ball and she's ready to go. And God bless you, sister. And she's been a real blessing to us, and she really helps out.
Yeah.
And I say helps out. She runs the show on that on our YouTube channel. So we praise the Lord for you. And wave at me, Tasha. There she is. Hey, there you go. She's waving. Yes, waving.
Read it if you could remain standing, and our brother Carl is going to come. Brother, here he comes. Our scripture reading is taken from Psalms 150, and we're going to read it from verses 1 through 6. 150 in your King James Bible, verses 1 to 6. And it reads, "Praise ye the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of a trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath,
yes,
praise the Lord."
Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, brother. At this time, I'm going to ask you to take your seats and like to turn your attention to our church announcements with our sister Gordon.
Good morning, all.
Good morning.
And welcome to everyone joining us on live stream. To Heritage Baptist Church, 1380 Fifth Avenue, Bayshore, New York, 11706, by Cash App, HBC Long Island at gmail.com, by PayPal at paypal.me/HBC123, and by offering plate, which will come around at the end of the service. Thank you for your attention to the announcements. God bless.
All right, thank you, dear sister. I did want to reiterate just a couple of things. First of all, our Wednesday night services, folks I know getting off of work on Wednesday and then coming out. Man, we're learning how to do a lot of good stuff. We're learning how to take care of our families when the power goes out, we're learning how to kill something and drag it home and eat it. You know, real man stuff here, so we're in our Christian survival series. That can be blessed by your presence and by your help. Amen. We are to be encouraging one another, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. Amen. Praise the Lord. Say
amen.
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 I'm wondering. I'm amening by myself up here.
Amen.
Hey, all right. Listen, let's look to the Lord and let's pray together. Can you stand together? Let's pray. Let's pray about these issues. for the fact that you love us. And your word tells us, and you demonstrate on a daily basis, that you do love us. As undeserving as we are, yet and still you are mindful of man. And we thank you for that, Father. Now help us to love you in return, to respond to your love with love for you. Lord, help us to walk in the Spirit. Lord, guide our tongues, our minds, our actions, our deeds. Lord, help us to walk in a way that would show our walk with you and our testimony of you, Lord, that would show you in the best light, that the world would see that true Christianity does exist. Conditions and are going through situations, Lord, where we need your help. And so, Lord, we ask that in the name of Jesus, Lord, you would touch bodies, touch minds, touch hearts. And, Lord, that you would heal. Lord, we pray that you would bring about a healing that the doctors say will never take place. Lord, we pray, Father, that you would touch with your divine touch. And Lord, cause your people to stand up straight. Lord, to walk in you Lord, to walk with healthy bodies and healthy minds. Lord, deliver your people, I pray, Father, from addictions. Lord, from diseases. Lord, from the things that are in us. We ask, Lord, for financial blessings. And those that are struggling to pay the bills, to put food on the table. Lord, those that are struggling, I pray, Father, that you would give wisdom in finances. And that you would give blessings in finances. And Lord, help us to be good stewards of all that you've given us. And Father, if our lifestyle and our habits are causing you to withhold the blessings to us, then Father, open our eyes and show us so that we might walk in a fellowship with you and that all that you give us would be given. For Father, we know you desire to bless. So Lord, we ask that you would bless us, that we might bless you, and that you would be glorified. In Jesus' name, we ask it for thanksgiving. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path.
When I feel afraid,
Am I on?
The light was on.
All right, how about now?
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
Oh, now he says amen. Amen. I walk up to the podium in silence. I heard a cricket. But I got an amen from Calvin X. Praise the Lord. In your Bibles this morning, the book of Jeremiah, chapter 13. The book of Jeremiah and chapter 13. We are dealing with our... the series entitled, You Are in Good Hands. So aptly titled because if you didn't remind yourself periodically in reading through the book of Jeremiah, you might forget that you're in good hands. You might forget that what God is doing, He's doing for the good. Sometimes life is it unfolds in such a way that you can't see too much good coming out of it. I don't see any good in this that I'm going through, Lord. So I got a girdle according to the word of the Lord and put it on my loins. And the word of the Lord came unto me second time saying, take the girdle that thou hast got, which is upon thy loins, and arise and go to Euphrates and hide it. Hide it there in a hole of a rock. So I went hid it by Euphrates as the Lord commanded me. Father, thank you for your word. Now, Lord, allow us, I pray, to hear from you. Not merely words, but, Father, that to hear by your spirit. Speak to our spirits, Father. Draw us to yourself. You know the spiritual need. Lord, meet us at that point of spiritual need, and we'll thank you for it. In Jesus Christ's name we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Have you ever interacted with someone, had the experience of watching someone go through something, doing something, and you know the way they were doing is going to do nothing but cause harm to themselves? Amen. What they're doing is wrong, and you know a better way. In fact, you know the right way that would help them succeed in what they want to do.
Amen.
But they won't listen to you. Have you ever been in a situation like that where they just will not listen to you to their own detriment? That's a frustrating thing. That's a frustrating thing to incur, to happen, to experience. Especially if this is a person that you love and you're trying to help, but they will not accept your help.
Yeah.
Well, what I'm describing to you is the ministry of Jeremiah. What I'm describing to you is the heart of the Lord God. Because this is oftentimes how we treat the Lord. When we decide to do things the way we want to do them, and God is the one who knows the right way. In fact, God has already told us in His Word how He wants us to live. But when we decide to live our way, then God looks at us and says, I'm trying to help you. I'm giving you the answers. Oftentimes, folks, we don't even have to figure it out.
Amen.
Because God has given us the answers.
Yes. Amen.
And the Lord is looking at what we're doing, and I know it hurts His heart. I know that it does. Jeremiah is going through this ministry. This is the ministry that God has given him. And I think what we're dealing with here is really what describes his ministry. Now, in the first seven chapters, chapter seven verses, He basically begins by giving them the results. Generally, the results are at the end. Amen? Well, what he's doing in these first seven verses is he's telling them what the end is, the end of their actions. In other words, because of what you've done, this is what you are. Now, he says that he hid this linen girdle under a rock in a hole. By the way, this linen girdle that he told him to... I know, listen, when we say girdle, I know what most of you are thinking. That's not what it is. All right, he wasn't trying to keep anything in, if you know what I mean. All right? This was part of the priestly robe, the priestly clothing. The book of Numbers tells us that when the priests were to get dressed, God had specific clothing that he wanted his priests to wear. That's slowly, slowly, gradually now disappearing because, well, we don't have to give God anything special. We can get up and, listen, some folk get up in the morning and go out to the mall in their pajamas. I wonder if they brush their teeth. Some folks still have bed hair. Amen. I never go to the mall with bed hair. Oh, he thought that was funny. But he had a specific wardrobe that the priests were supposed to wear when they were ministering in the house of God. The word of God has always been that way. Throughout the Old Testament, you were expected to do something in your dress that was different when you come to the house of God. In the New Testament, the Lord Jesus gave the example of the man that everyone was welcome to come, and they came to the wedding, and then he looked at one and said, how come you're not dressed for the wedding? You don't have the right clothing on. You know where you are, and you have a special invitation. It's a privilege for you to be here. You don't just come dragging yourself in here any old kind of way. Amen. 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 This was New Testament. This was New Testament. That doesn't mean you're more spiritual than anybody because you have on a dress and a suit and a tie. Right. That's not what it means. But it does mean that you're mindful of what you put on that morning when you went to worship God.
Yes. Amen.
And that's what God is watching.
Amen.
Get a girdle. It goes around the loins. That's your core. And the priests were supposed to wear that in along with the ephod and everything else that they had. So he says, get this priestly garment and then go and hide it under a rock. So I went, verse 5, and hid it by Euphrates as the Lord commanded. Many days, Jeremiah was then seen, the next thing we're going to read here, as seen walking through Jerusalem, preaching the word of God. Now wait a minute, 7 years later he looked a little different. The beginning of it, he had on this linen cloth and he was there preaching, and then he went and he hid it. And it came to pass, verse 6, after many days, that the Lord said unto me, arise and go to Euphrates, and take the girdle from thence, which I commanded thee to hide there. And I went to Euphrates and digged and took the girdle from the place where I had hid it. And behold, God sees you, something that is marred and that is unprofitable. He said, put no water on this garment. You know what that means? Don't wash it. Put it under a rock. Let it remain in the elements for 7 years. And then go back and get it and put it on. How many of you like getting dressed up?
Amen.
I mean, doesn't that help you? Don't you feel a little something when you get dressed up?
Amen.
I hear folks saying today, oh, I hate getting dressed up. But you know, we're losing that also.
Yeah.
We're losing that also. They did something I hate that they did. They made a shirt. Oh, it's a dress shirt, and you don't have to tuck this in your pants. It's untucked. To you.
Amen.
It helps your psyche.
Right.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
They're getting spiritual on me here. Men, it does the same thing to us.
Amen.
We have too many men. The more, well, hey, I can't stand getting dressed up and wearing a tie. I just feel more comfortable in jeans. And well, yes, let's admit this is more comfortable than wearing a pair of shorts. All right? But it does something altogether different. It's a difference. It altogether different. It makes a difference when you're clean and when you're dirty.
Amen.
Amen. All right, well, they're with me on that. Amen. Praise the Lord. And now he's telling him to go get this dirty. Between you and the Lord. But he said that this, behold, the girdle was marred and was profitable, he says, for nothing. It was good, girl. It was good. There was nothing wrong with it. But now, here we are years later, it has lost its purpose. It has lost its profitability. It cannot be used anymore. It is possible for a person to be called of God so that God can use that person, but then walk away from and lose and miss their calling.
Yes.
Yes.
It's possible for a person to be legitimately called of God,
yes,
but then turn from their calling and no longer be usable to God.
Yes. Yes.
You say, well, I don't know if I agree with that. Well, then what do you think the word unprofitable means? And what do you think this example is? You were good. You were fine. You were what I called you to be. But now you are not. Well, somebody says, well, then if you sink that low, can you ever get it back? I mean, if you know God's calling in your life, and ladies and gentlemen, you and I ought to know the calling of God in our life. What is your calling? You ought to know that. I didn't ask you what your job is and what you do and what you like. Because your calling may be something that you don't like.
Amen.
But God doesn't call you based on your likes and your preferences. God doesn't call you based on your abilities. But there's a calling that God has, that the Holy Spirit of God, who abides in you, will bring you through that calling and enable you to do it by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Will you ever get it back? Well, maybe yes, and maybe no. It's possible, but for some, it is not possible. You know, there are some that they have disqualified themselves from the position of that calling that God had on their lives.
Amen.
Will they ever get that calling back? No, they will not. And he's talking about these, and he says that they are marred. He says that they have turned away from what God called them to be and to do, and God's original. And the problem is, far too often, our will is always done. Far too often, it is our will that takes precedence over God's will. There are those that have rejected God's word, and they're pushing away God's word, God's hand. And our message this morning is simply just don't push away the hand of God. Don't push God's hand away. Let me speak to those just briefly here, to those who are resisting the call of God. That God is calling, and God wants to do something in your life, and God wants to change something in you, but you are resisting his call. I want to say to you this morning, you're living on very dangerous, very shaky ground. Very shaky ground, because these people live in such a way that now God is showing them the results, and he's using words like, you're an unprofitable servant. And these that continue to reject God and push his word, pushes his hand away, they're living in a dangerous time because they are more concerned with doing their own thing and living their own way as opposed to living as God would have them to. I've heard people say, when God called me to do this, I fought him and I fought him and I fought him. Well, you better stop fighting.
Amen.
Because that's not the time to start fighting. The time you're supposed to fight the devil, not God.
Amen.
Yes. Amen?
Amen.
Watch what he says. Verse 8. Then said the Lord God, then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, thus saith the Lord, after this manner will I mar the pride of Judah. Put this girdle on, and look at this girdle. And after this manner will I mar the pride of Judah. And for this evil people which refuse to hear my words, which walk in the imagination of their heart, and walk after other gods to serve them and to worship them, shall even be as this girdle, which is good for nothing. Now wait a minute. Would God ever say that you're good for nothing? I mean, would God ever say that? I mean, he's the God of heaven. Would he ever say, yeah, you're good for nothing? Folks, he just said it. Did you read it? Good for G-O-O-D-F-O-R-N-O-T-H-I-N. He wrote good for nothing. And there are some people who have walked away from the Lord, not serving the Lord, not living for the Lord, and not even concerned with it. God cannot use them. They will not allow God to use them. They will not yield to the Lord, surrender to the Lord. And God says they're good for nothing.
Yep.
Well, I don't believe that. You don't have to believe the Bible if you don't want to. But read it, and then after you read it, then say that again. I'm reading that. I don't believe that. Point to the verse you don't believe. I would never do that. Well, then stop saying it. Well, then stop saying it. He said of these people they're unprofitable, and he said of these people that they're good for nothing. But notice what he called them in In verse 10, he says, this evil people. This evil people. What makes them evil? Are people that are not interested in the Word of God. Not interested in the Word of God. Not interested really at all in the Word of God. Now listen, these are not necessarily people that are angry with God. These aren't people necessarily who doubt God. But here's evil people. Now let's see, a person that's angry, man, I hate God, I'm angry. We can see that's evil, right? That's easy. All right? That's easy. Doubt, well, I don't know if there is a God, and so I'm just going to live the way. We can see where, okay, that's evil. But it doesn't have to be that. Generally, here is the evil that slips by us. Will not walk with it, that refuse, that push his hand away. God describes them as evil, as unprofitable, as good for nothing.
Amen.
Folks, I got the words directly from Scripture.
Amen.
I didn't even embellish. That's what it says.
Amen.
And he's talking about one group, the group who will not obey his word. Verse 9. Thus says, Word of God, that's evil. And he says, and they shall be just like this girl. Now you thought Elijah looked bad, and Elijah was known for the camel's hair and the way he dressed, and his hair looked wild, and Elijah walked in and people stepped back just looking at him. This is the guy that got you go across the street when he's walking on the sidewalk there. You thought Elijah looked bad. Jeremiah's got on a dirty girdle that's been under a rock, in the elements, probably didn't smell too good. But what is he doing? He's got that wrapped around him, and he's walking through the streets in Jerusalem, and he's preaching to the people, and they're looking at him and saying, isn't that Jeremiah supposed to be a prophet? What's he preaching now? And he says, you see this girdle that I have on? You see how marred it is and it's good for nothing? I shouldn't even have it on. It's not helping me. It's not doing anything. It's got holes in it. You can see through it. God says this is how you have marred yourself in his eyes. Of Israel and the whole house of Judah, saith the Lord, that they might be unto me. Now watch this. Here's what God said I wanted for you, that they might be unto me. Cleave to me, the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah, so that they might be unto me a people and for a name, and for praise, and for glory. But they would not hear. For people, I want you to be my people. For a name, to bear my name. For praise, to praise the God of heaven, and people will see that what you're doing, and they'll praise God too. For glory, you see what I have for you? You see what I want for you? This is fellowship in God. This is fellowship with me, and this is what, but you will. Said, but you would not. And therefore, Jesus knew that now I'm going to have to die and leave you in the condition that you're in. Because the blessing is here and you're pushing it away. In fact, you are literally crucifying your blessing. But aren't you glad that God's so many steps ahead of us?
Amen.
Yes.
Because God sent us one that has to be crucified. In order that the blood might shed.
Yes.
Because it's got to have blood. There's got to be blood. Yes. So he sent one and he counted. Do, but the first thing I know you're going to do, you're going to condemn yourself in killing the one that was sent to bless you, and by doing but I think God knows what he's doing.
Amen.
We see he showed the results of the people. Look at the reward of the people. Verse 12, the Bible says, therefore, thou shalt speak unto them this word. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel. Everybody's bottle shall be filled with wine, and they shall say unto thee, do we not certainly know that every bottle shall be filled with wine? Then shalt thou say unto them, thus saith the Lord. Behold, I will fill all in the inhabitants of the land, even the kings that sit in David's throne, and the priests and the prophets and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem with drunkenness. And I'll dash them one against another, even the father and the son together, saith the Lord. I will not pity nor spare nor have mercy, but destroy them. God says, here's the reward you're going to have. I'm going to give you a blessing of much and of good. Every bottle is going to be filled with wine. And then he rehearsed a conversation. Jeremiah, just to show you, God is God. And he knows what's going on. Jeremiah, here's a message I want you to preach. Tell them every bottle is going to be filled with wine. Prosperity across the land. And he says, and then they're going to say to you,
right.
You say, don't go outside without a coat on. It's 3 degrees outside. I don't care. It won't bother me. They will take their clothes off and walk outside in 3 degrees. They will get frostbite and lose toes, fingers, tips of noses, and ears.
Amen.
Amen. God said, here's what's going to happen. About the blessings that are coming. And they're so used to being blessed, they're saying, well, yeah, he knows. Think about this nation that he's talking about here. That's not our nation, it's this nation. I'm going to bless you and you're going to have blessings far above all the other nations. Not our nation now. This nation here he's talking about here. And you're going to have abundance of everything. And you're going to be so used to the blessings of God in the abundance that you're going to mar yourselves. You're going to take the blessings of God and you're going to turn those things and you're going to turn Was it 2:4? One of those. The goodness of God, the blessings of God are supposed to draw us to the Lord. But not only do they not draw us to the Lord, the blessings of God don't even draw us in a better fellowship with our own selves.
Amen.
People will be blessed with an abundance. And people will say, yeah, look at him. He forgot where he came from.
Yeah.
Look at him. She thinks she's better than everybody now. And why would they say that about you? Probably because you do. They're probably telling the truth. People change when they get money.
Amen.
No, I've got to be a little louder than that. People change when they get money.
Amen.
Now we're saying amen like we know. Yes, we do know firsthand. Because we've seen other people get money and he says, the blessings. Listen, we need to make sure we understand something. Don't make the mistake of allowing the blessings of God to keep you from the presence of God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Because that can happen so easily.
Yes.
So completely. He says, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you all of this. And you're going to take it and you're going to have it. And from all the blessings, you're just going to get drunk on it. And then you're going to start fighting amongst each other. There's going to be chaos in the camp. And you're going to argue with this one. And this one is a political argument. I'm on this side, you're on that side. And we have this wonderful nation that we live in, but we can't get along because he doesn't like this one. And they're not of my people and of my party and they're this. And they're segregating this and that. And nations of everyone. And all of these times, it all falls apart. Well, you know what God says? I love you and I'm blessing you. You want me to stop blessing you? You have a choice. Either I stop blessing you, or you receive the blessings and do right.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Which one will you choose? Well, no, you want choice 3. Keep blessing. And we do wrong. Amen. There we are. Amen. Praise the Lord. There we go. See, God just forgot the option B. Verse 15. We see the rebuke of the Lord in verse 15. It says, hear ye and give ear. Be not proud. Be not what? Proud. for the Lord has spoken. Give glory to the Lord your God before he calls darkness, and before your feet stumble upon the dark mountains, and while ye look for light, he turn it into shadow of death and make it gross light or gross darkness. He says, verse 17, but if thou wilt not hear it, my soul shall weep in secret places for your pride. For your pride. Verse 15, hear ye, give ear, be not proud. Verse 17, but if ye will not hear it, my soul shall weep in secret places for your pride. Pride. And mine eyes shall weep sore and run down with tears because the Lord's flock is scattered away captive. He says, verse 18, say unto the king, now wait a minute. When God says, humble yourself, when God says, give ear and listen, God can be very direct when he says, you need to stop being so proud and to humble yourself. You notice I'm emphasizing this because the Word of God emphasizes this. He's speaking of pride. He's speaking of being proud. You know what a proud person is? A proud person is one who does wrong, but then convinces themselves that their wrong is right and proud of it. I am proud. Proud is the opposite of being ashamed. When we commit sin and we go against the Word of God, we should be ashamed. Yes. But that word we're trying to eradicate from our vocabulary in this nation. You are not supposed to be ashamed of anything. Whatever you want to do, be proud of it. Stand up, let the world know. I'm proud of my sinful ways. You see this lifestyle, these things I'm doing? I'm proud of it. Watch what he says here. He says, again, verse 15, hear ye and give ear. Be not proud, for the Lord hath spoken. Give glory to the Lord your God before he calls darkness and before your feet stumble upon the dark mountains. He says, do this now. Last warning. Darkness, you know what that means? That means your pride will cause God to put your lights out. It's called darkness. And he said, do it before he turns the light out. That's called a warning, folks. That says, we're supposed to say, well, God's giving me another chance. I blew it, I messed up, I was living the way I wanted to live, I didn't have time for God, I wasn't quite ready. But God says, do it now before he turns the light out. And when he turns the light out, then you're going to stumble in the dark.
Right.
Child of God, we're supposed to walk in the light as children of the light.
Amen.
But for those that will not walk with him, he's not giving the light, he will give the darkness. He says, Jeremiah is saying, my soul is crying for the pride of our people. And then notice this, as he says this, to humble yourselves, and I want to watch this, verse 18, and say unto the king, now sometimes I think, God, you're just trying to get Jeremiah killed here. All right, verse 18, say unto the king and to the queen, humble yourselves and sit down. Excuse me, your honor, your highness. My name is Jeremiah. I'm the prophet of God. I have a message to you from the Lord. What's your message? Shut up and sit down. Humble yourselves and sit down. Who's he talking to? The king and the queen. Make sure both of them are there. Both know that they are not in charge. God is.
Amen.
And right now, God has put his man in charge because he's telling you, king and queen, what to do. Humble yourself. That means be quiet. And sit down. That was fighting words. You want to make somebody mad? You want to just tell them, look, shut up and sit down. Next time your boss says, you should have done that, you missed your deadline here, you did that, you let him know God's in charge. Boss, listen, I want you to know something. God told me to tell you, shut up and sit down. Now, I guarantee you, that word is so powerful, you will only have to say that to your boss once. Power in the word of God. The word of God. Say it to the king and to the queen, verse 18. Humble yourselves, sit down, for your principality shall come down. Even the crown of your glory, God's going to come in and take over. The cities of the south shall be shut up. None shall open them. Judah shall be carried away captive. All of it. It shall be wholly carried away. Well, there's a lot we can say about this, but remember this. Those of us that live in a nation that's turning from the Lord, when the nation turns from the Lord and suffering comes, God's people are going to take part in the suffering also. The suffering is going to affect us also, but it's going to be handled in a different way. There's not going to be despair. We're not going to be distraught over it. We're going to say God's in control. We're going to say Jehovah Jireh. I'm just waiting for him to do it. We're not going to be jumping out of windows, child of God. We're not going to be beating up our family members and each other. No. There's going to be the peace of God in our home as much in poverty as there is in riches. Lift up your eyes, verse 20, and behold them that come from the north. Where is the flock that was given thee, thy beautiful flock? What wilt thou say when he shall punish thee? For thou hast taught them to be captains as the chief over thee. Shall not sorrow take thee as a woman in travail? You think, what will you say? You think of the sins that we're involved in. And this is a sin of pride. Not listening to the Lord and thinking that I know better and thinking that I can do better. I mean, we're really falling into that whole spirit. I mean, we're in there, but now it's permeating everywhere now. Now, I know better than doctors now in the year 2022. Can't trust the It's embarrassment. Now you're embarrassed because you said so much and in your pride you are know-it-all, but then you were found to be wrong on every point. It embarrasses.
Yeah.
I think that's worse. I mean, worse than being ashamed. Now, this is my opinion. This is my opinion. I'll let you know though. But worse than being ashamed of something is to be publicly embarrassed about. There's some shame that's in that also. But to be embarrassed. I was wrong. I was outed in front of everyone. Now those that looked up to me are now pointing the finger and saying, that's really what you were like? Oh, we thought better of you than that. Wait a minute. There's some embarrassment that he's talking about here. We see this rebuke of the Lord. What will thou say, verse 21, when you're punished, when he punishes thee, when he punished thee? For thou hast taught them to be captains and chiefs over thee. Shall not sorrows take thee as a woman in travail? This is one of those colloquial phrases that they would use to show an embarrassment and to show your indecency. Your heels are made. Dark skin was a curse from God, and God cursed them with dark skin, and that's what the curse was there. But what he's saying is, can the Ethiopian change his skin? Now he's saying that because he's saying. What he says is the Ethiopian is an Ethiopian. The leopard is a leopard. And you are a sinner, accustomed to doing wrong. When the hand of God comes down hard on this nation, people do say and will say the same thing. Lord, what have we done? It is possible for people to be so accustomed to sin that they don't recognize it anymore. Okay. To be so in their habitual nature, doing things wrong and not realize, come to the point where they don't realize that that's sin and it's wrong and you shouldn't be doing it. Especially in a nation as affluent as ours. We have everything and more of it than we need. Look at the stats about how much food we throw away. And other nations are starving. And we even have people in our nation that are starving. And we're throwing food away. Because some are living more affluent than others. You ought to feel bad every time you have food in your freezer and it spoils. And your refrigerator goes bad. Every carton of milk, you ought to feel bad. You ought to start praying for the cows. You ought to walk up to the farm down the road here and walk up to the first cow and apologize. We have so much. And then we turn from the Lord because of our affluence, because of our abundance. We turn from the Lord and we don't have time. Listen, it's 99 degrees outside, but we're in air-conditioned homes. And ooh, we sleep under a blanket when it's 99 degrees outside because we got it like that. And you know when we sleep under that blanket? 8, 9, 10, 11. It's because, here's the answer, he says, because can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leper the spots? Then may ye also do good, which are accustomed to do evil. Therefore, he says, I will scatter them as the stubble that pass away by the wind of the wilderness. This is thy lot, the portion of thy measures from me, saith the Lord. Because thou hast forgotten me and trusted in falsehood, therefore will I discover thy skirts upon thy face, that thy shame may appear. Imagery. Here we go again. Therefore, I will discover your skirts upon your face. I wish I had a... I should. I should. We have to demonstrate this. God says, I'm going to make you ashamed. I'm going to embarrass you. So here's what I'm going to do. This is my skirt. Not hard to imagine. I saw a girl walking around in the mall in a skirt about this size. She had her daughter with her, too. Thy names, you're lusting after others, someone else, somebody, some something. You're like a horse neighing after another. Look at that over there. Your names, that's what he says. I've seen that. God's got a problem with that. He says, I've seen thine adulteries and thy names, the lewdness of thy whoredom, and thine abominations on the hills, in the fields. Woe unto thee, O Jerusalem! Wilt thou not be made clean? When shall it once be? O Jerusalem, woe, Jerusalem! Do you want to be made clean? Will thou not be made clean? Don't you want to come out of that? Don't continue to live that way. When the offer will not be extended anymore, there will come a time when those who reject the Lord It's over now. Oh, why is it that this doesn't bother me anymore? But without the Spirit of God working in you, none of us, without the Spirit of God working and drawing us, none of us would come to the Lord. None of us would come to the Lord. You know why we come to the Lord? Because we feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit of God, and we know within ourselves, this is right, I need to come to the Lord. I just need to come. I need to turn to the Lord. Yes. I need to surrender to the Lord.
Amen.
I see the life I'm living in. I want to do what I want to do. I don't want God to tell me or the pastor or anything. We're sinners by nature, and we're sinners by choice.
Mm-hmm.
And we're sinners by habit. Mm-hmm. Because man is so depraved. There's nothing in us that is good. Romans 3:10. None are good. Not one of us. The Word of God tells us that. And God loves us anyway. Loves us enough to send His Son to die for us.
Yeah.
And then he says, why won't you come? Why would you die in your sins? Why would you do that? Well, God, I'm not worth anything. You already told me I'm good for nothing. So I might as well. We're responsible. We're about God's will. Our Father, our Lord, and our God, we desire that your will be accomplished in our lives more so than ours. So Lord, help us to humble ourselves and to sit down and to walk in the blessings of God and the love of God. Lord, help us to be sensitive to the moving of your Holy Spirit. Now bless in this invitation time. And Lord, hear our prayers as we fall on our knees and we pray unto you. In Christ's name, we ask you.